Welcome to Public Health On Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Our focus is the novel coronavirus. I'm Josh Sharfstein, a faculty member at Johns Hopkins and also a former secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal with this podcast is to bring evidence and experts to help you understand today's news about the novel coronavirus and what it means for tomorrow. If you have questions, you can email them to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. This new podcast has been downloaded over 1.5 million times in the past 5 months, thanks to listeners like you. Next week, we'll be launching season 2 of the podcast, bringing you more evidence and experience about a broader range of topics, including, but not limited to, COVID-19. This week, we're checking in with some people we interviewed in some of our original episodes from season 1. Today, I'm speaking with Dr. Justin Lessler, our very first interviewee on the podcast. Dr. Lessler is an expert in infectious disease dynamics, and when we first spoke, he had a lot of unanswered questions about the novel coronavirus. Now, he still has some. Let's listen. Dr. Lessler, thank you so much for coming back on the Public Health On Call podcast. I remember our first interview because I was actually in your office physically, probably seated about 6 feet away, asking you questions. At the time, I remember you were quite concerned about the virus and predicted that it could well spread across the world. I want to start by just asking what we've learned about the virus since then, and what do you think about its potential for continuing to spread?
Yeah, so, I mean, of course, the first thing we learned is it was able to spread across the world. I think we know a bit more about how it spreads now, that it, you know, can spread a bit before people develop symptoms, and can spread after. You know, we know it does infect people of all ages, even though there's still some question of whether kids might be slightly less susceptible than adults. It seems like that might be the case, but it's hard to know for sure, but it's clear they do get infected, and they do occasionally infect people. You know, some of the things we saw early on have been borne out, you know, like the importance of super spreading events, that, you know, particular events where lots of people get infected remain really important, or are very important in how this virus spreads. Some of the things, you know, some of these things are still up for debate. You know, like, why do those super spreading events occur? Is aerosolized transmission a really important part of that, or is it something else that's driving that? Those types of things are still being debated. So there's still a lot of unknowns, but I think we're starting to have a better picture. One of the big things I think we were uncertain about at that point was exactly how deadly the virus was. You know, I don't remember what I said then, but I'm guessing I said it could be anywhere from 1 in 1,000 to 1 in 100. Now we know it's somewhere probably just over 1 in 200 people who get infected who die. So that's, it's important to remember, that's like lower than the number of cases, the number of people who like go to the doctor and are reported or died, is the number of people who get infected with the virus at all, whether or not they develop symptoms. And that's, so it's about 0.5% or 1 in 200 people die, which is severe. It's not as bad as, say, the 1918 flu, but it's a lot worse than I certainly was thinking it might be in those early days.
So the bottom line is some spread without symptoms, and more deadly than you thought. So would you say that in general, your view of this virus has gotten, you know, more pessimistic as more information has come? Or what's it like as an expert? I know you study infectious disease spread. You know, when you've been learning things, is it a mix of things? Is it good news? Is it bad news? How do you think about it now?
I think there's good news and bad news. Like, certainly, in our first wave of social distancing measures and, you know, stay at home orders and stuff, I think that was more effective than I expected it to be. I think we were able to act faster than I expected, that people would act, and it was more effective than I thought. Also, the resurgence we're in the midst of now has been slower to start. I know everybody who's freaking out about how much it is now is going to be surprised to hear this, but it's coming a lot slower than I thought it was going to. I thought it would be coming up a lot stronger. So those things have been positive, but yeah, it is more deadly than I certainly had thought it would be. And I think the situation around immunity is less clear. I don't, hopefully it does provide some long lasting immunity, but I think there's a lot of worries that it won't. And that is going to be something to worry about. But ultimately, I think we've done, as dysfunctional as parts of the response have been, we've dodged a lot of the worst outcomes that I was worried about so far. Like, only in New York City, really, did things get completely, completely out of control in the first wave. I'm not optimistic that's going to stay the case given the recent events.
So let's talk about the response a bit more. So you were impressed that the response was fast initially. I know that was a big source of concern, and that we dodged the collapse of the healthcare system the first time around. What do you think is now going to happen, and what can be done to stave off this virus at this point?
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to try to read the political tea leaves too much. I'll fail. And I think a lot of it has to do, like, I still think a lot of what's going to happen is in our hands. I think what we should try to be working towards is a middle path. Like, I'll be the first to say that, you know, having schools closed for, you know, a year or more while we wait for a vaccine, and, you know, not have shutting down the economy for that amount of time is not, like, that's not a viable solution. But to do that, I think we need to spend more resources on the things we know that work. You know, we know, for instance, that, you know, in the right situations, when we've knocked things down enough, that, like, contact tracing followed by, you know, isolation and quarantine of people, of those contacts, can have a really big impact if we get things under control. But it really requires a lot of resources to make that happen. We know that, you know, masks can have some effect. It's not, you know, like, at least some incremental effect on transmission, but we need that to be widespread. We know that, you know, it's clear that, you know, not having mass gatherings, you know, social distancing measures are really effective. I mean, that's how we knocked it back. And probably don't, I think, given the way the virus spreads, probably don't need to be at the level of everybody staying in their houses all the time. We're not certain about that, but I don't think that is so. We need to figure out how to make those happen and still do the things that are important to us. You know, do what we know is effective to control the virus while still doing the things that are important while we get better at treatment, we get better pharmaceutical interventions, and hopefully eventually a vaccine that will allow us to ease off those things. I know I'm rambling a bit, but just to say, like, I think it's not going to be, the way we lick this thing isn't going to be like one day there's a magic bullet, the vaccine comes out and stuff, and we're going to be like, we got it. It's going to be like, we're going to do little things here and there. We'll get a somewhat effective vaccine, you know, maybe a prophylactic treatment or two. And then one day, you know, we'll wake up and say, oh, I guess this isn't such a big deal anymore. And it's going to happen incrementally with small wins. But we need to, you know, we need to invest in all of those across the whole range of potential interventions to really make that happen.
So in the very short term, I'm just going to pick up one thread that you dangled there, that you don't know whether things are going to get so bad this time that
could things actually be worse than they were the first time? And if you were advising one of these cities or states that's having just enormous numbers of cases, understanding that maybe a full lockdown isn't necessary, what are the kinds of things that you think really need to be on the table so you can get to a point where this is something that we can slowly chip away at?
Yeah, and I'll say right now, I think, you know, given the broader geographic spread this time, I suspect at if looking at the national level, it'll get worse than it was the first way through. It, you know, whether anywhere gets as bad as New York did, you know, I don't know. But I think at the whole, at the level of the whole nation, my guess is it gets worse. But yeah, I think you have to start, you know, I think, you know, you have to start walking back some of your opening of businesses, you know, and things like that. You know, maybe going a little bit back to more of a essential services framework. I think a lot of businesses, some we didn't expect, have shown themselves to be really good at operating safely. Like, I know a lot of salons, for instance, have, you know, I know doctors, you know, who've gone to the salons and say, oh my gosh, if we could only achieve the level of carefulness that they're achieving in the hospital, we'd be so happy. That, like, you know, I think, like, the, you know, it's not necessarily, you know, everything, but I think, you know, unfortunately, I mean, I know people who depend on it for their livelihood, but bars and stuff like that, probably, you definitely need to close those. I think mandatory masking orders are definite. I think probably, yeah, indoor dining in general, and then, you know, ramping up contact tracing. And if you do get a little, so the thing that disappointed me about the first wave is that we bought time. I think that the shutdown orders bought us time, and I think if we were really thinking clearly about what we were doing, we would have understood that that's all they could ever do for us, right? You know, as soon as you take them off, you've done nothing to make the virus come back. So you have to use that time to build up, you know, all the things that you need to control the virus when it's open. And so, like, I think anytime we can buy to make testing, like, just much, much more available. So as you know, we're doing a lot of work trying to analyze what makes contact tracing programs work or not. And the biggest factor is what proportion of people you can bring in to be that first person so you can go trace their contacts,
right?
How many people you can capture to be that primary case. And that requires a lot of on-demand testing. And, you know, right now, testing rates have gone up, but in the recent surge, all the big labs have been overwhelmed. So, you know, turnaround times for, you know, places like, I think the hospital, like, you know, like Hopkins Hospital can still turn stuff around in, you know, less than a day. But, you know, the big outpatient providers are taking, you know, almost 2 weeks. And, you know, a test result 2 weeks after you get it is all but useless.
Yeah. So some really important short-term steps, building the public health capacity, and then waiting to chip away at it, therapeutics, vaccines, masking, careful, more care from people in their everyday lives.
Yeah. Right. I think you have to come at it with, like, social distancing is still social distancing plus, you know, if, you know, plus, you know, harm mitigation, like mask stuff is still our best first line that we have. So yeah, you have to come back at it with some of those and then use that time to build up those more general public health things and hopefully build up testing. I think if I could ask for one realistic, I mean, if I could ask for any tool right now, obviously it would be an effective vaccine that we could give to everyone, right? But if I could ask for one realistic tool that I think is within the grasp of having widespread within a couple months, it would be a test that even a low sensitivity test, so even one that missed a lot of cases, but that was cheap enough and easy enough to give that you could be giving it to people, you know, every couple of days and they can administer themselves. If we could do that and test that widely, I think that could be transformative.
Well, maybe we'll have a chance in a few months to check back in. Thank you so much for spending some time with me again.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening to Public Health on Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Please send questions to be covered in future podcasts to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. This podcast is produced by Josh Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Lamare Morales. Audio production by Niall Owen McCusker and Spencer Greer, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Thank you for listening.